Hello, I'm John Bangay. This is Stamford in South Lincolnshire, probably England's finest preserved Georgian town. It straddles the Great North Road, which comes in from the south from London, passes underneath here, past the George Hotel with its gallows sign across the road, out towards York and on to Edinburgh and Scotland. In 1967, Stamford was the first town in England to be granted conservation status. And as a result, it's like stepping back into a preserved Georgian world. Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good day, kind sir.
Many of the medieval churches have been preserved, and their towers and their spires still dot the town skyline. This is the tower of St Martin's Church.
And here, inside St Martin's Church,
is the tomb of the great Lord Burghley, Queen Elizabeth I's great minister. All Saints, here in Red Lion Square, is often called the heart of Stamford, with its blind arcading and its west window, donated by the American descendants of the Brown family in 1890. And this is the Church of St John the Baptist, famous for its wooden roof with carved wooden angels. St Michael's Church here in the High Street is now deconsecrated, but it still provides a beautiful backdrop for the shoppers. And behind me in the graveyard, there are seats where you can relax and listen to the buskers who are sometimes here in the High Street.
Here in St George's Square is the small but exquisite St George's Church, where the wedding scene in the BBC drama Middlemarch was filmed. St George's Square and the adjacent Arts Centre were also used as film locations for the famous election scene in the BBC's adaptation of George Eliot's novel.
And finally, but certainly not least, St Mary's Church, which stands at the top of St Mary's Hill. Every time he crossed the bridge, the famous novelist Sir Walter Scott would raise his hat to St Mary's Church.
In 1917, the bell ringers of St Mary's rang out a peal for a last time and then departed to fight in the trenches of the First World War. Since that time, only the chimes of the clock have rung from this great steeple.
Stamford's not just about architectural heritage. It stands at the head of the tranquil Welland River Valley, and these are Freeman's Meadows, which have always been open to the people of Stamford and visitors to wander and enjoy. These are the town meadows. Here, Vaughan's Walk crosses the meadows. It follows the route of the ancient trackway into the old town of Stamford. It's called Vaughan's Walk after the French Mediterranean town of Vaughan, with which Stamford is twinned. Here, Vaughan's Walk runs into Castle Dyke, past the remains of the castle of the Norman William de Warenne, still called Warenne Keep. And elsewhere in the town, you can see the bastion, a last remaining fragment of the old town walls. Can I have an ice cream now?
No chance. Healthy option.
Celery? Here, at the top of Castle Dyke, is an area that used to be known as the sheep market. In ancient times, it was much bigger space. Uphill was Royal Christian Mercer. To this side was ancient Viking, pagan Danelaw. Friday is market day in Stamford. Stamford's always been a centre of commerce and trade. 600 years ago, there were many wealthy merchants living in the town, and one, William Brown, was the richest of them all. He built Brown's Hospital behind me, a kind of refuge for sick and elderly people. And even today, behind this beautiful building are small residences for old people.
At the edge of the town stands the well-preserved remains of St Leonard's Priory, one of the many religious houses closed by Henry VIII's Reformation.
Stamford's always been a centre of education and learning, and once, in the 14th century, some scholars from Oxford came here and tried to set up a university, but the king would not allow it and sent them back to Oxford. And all that's left now is the Brazen Nose. And of course, we still do have Brazen Nose College, Oxford.
Stamford's greatest time came at the peak of the stagecoach travel, because it stands almost halfway between London and York, and even further on to Scotland. And many stagecoach travellers pass through the town, staying overnight at hotels such as Stamford Hotel.
And most importantly, the George Hotel, with its famous gallows sign across the road. The George Hotel has been here for nearly 1,000 years. And at one time, it was a favourite resting place for the Crusaders. And later, in 1215, we think the barons met here to plan what became Magna Carta. In the stagecoach era, it was a very nice place to stay. And there are still two rooms called York and London.
Stamford once had its own racecourse, and a reminder of the luxurious lifestyle is shown by the waxwork of Daniel Lambert, once England's heaviest man.
And here, in Stamford Town Hall, is a statue of Daniel Lambert. When he died in Stamford in 1809, weighing 52 stones, he was reputedly the heaviest man in England. After his death, it took 20 men to carry his coffin. They even had to put wheels on it and cut a sloping path and wheel the coffin into the grave. You can see the gravestone now in St Martin's Churchyard.
Hello, I'm Councillor Susan Sandell, and I am the 336th Mayor of Stamford. This chain I'm wearing is one of only three with intersecting S's. The others are worn by the Mayor of London and the Mayor of Birmingham. It dates from 1863, but the coin, which is called a noble, dates from the reign of Edward IV. The small wand I'm holding is the oldest, given by Edward IV in 1462, together with the first royal charter we have on display in the cabinet. The royal charter given by Edward also gave us the town the autonomy with the right to show the three royal lines in the town's coat of arms that you can see at the top. The smaller mace given to replace one taken by Oliver Cromwell was presented in 1660. And the larger mace behind is used still today for official and civic ceremonies and is an exact replica of the one in the House of Commons. It was presented to the council in 1678.
One of the town's most notorious festivals was the annual bull running, when a bull was released in the streets and chased into the river. Now the town celebrates the event with a less violent ceremony, where a paper bull effigy is paraded and burnt on the town's historic meadows. And people in Georgian costumes take the town back to its heyday.
Now I'm here in Burley Park, and behind me you can see the wonderful Elizabethan mansion, Burley House, built by Lord Burley, Queen Elizabeth's first minister. It has a beautiful set of state rooms and the finest collection of 17th century Italian art outside Italy. Surrounding me here is the beautiful Burley Park, designed by the landscape gardener Capability Brown. And the people of Stamford can wander in it every day and sometimes mix with the herd of deer, but I can't see them around me today. I don't think they do bed and breakfast in there.
But the best thing about Stamford is its sheer variety and charm of its many preserved buildings and architecture. Just walk around the town and observe carefully the various window and door designs, delicate carvings, and winding cobbled passageways and streets.
Even the bread is 200 years old here. Well, not the bread, but the bakehouse is.
Good morning.
Can I have my usual granary, please? You can indeed.
One moment.
There you go. Have a good day.
Thank you.
And you.
Oh, it's hot. Very hot.
Take care. That's it.
The town lost its fame and fortune when Lord Burghley refused to allow the newfangled railways to disturb the peace of Stamford, and the Great Northern Railway passed through nearby Peterborough instead of Stamford. So the coaching trade, which had been Stamford's lifeblood, vanished almost overnight. And the town fell asleep, only to be gently reawakened 100 years later when the first motor cars trundled down St Martin's Hill. This is the best known view of Stamford, celebrated by the great painter Turner. In his picture, St Mary's is partly obscured by St Martin's in the foreground. I've used a little artistic license to show both churches and the George Hotel in between. You can see copies of my drawing in the Tourist Information Centre, as well as other souvenirs and guides to celebrate your visit to the beautiful and historic town of Stamford.
Stamford is my home now. I was brought up in a Lincolnshire village and I watched its medieval heritage, its woods, its trees, its hedges swept away in the 1960s agricultural revolution. But Stamford, now preserved, unchanging, in its streets, succeeding generations of rose-lipped maidens and light-foot lads, school and then move away and come back to noisily reunite themselves before moving into the wider world and leaving Stamford far behind. Some return later in life, or have remained in their seventh age, shuffling quietly along these same unchanging streets, while new, eager generations of fresh-faced youth rush merrily by, and all around them, the constant buildings and the sounds of Stamford, the heartbeat bells of All Saints, marks the passing of their days.